Thank you, Abby. It's great to be here in, I guess, actually one of my competitors, institution, because I understand this is a Warwick Business School room, so I guess I shouldn't really be here, but never mind. As you can see, I've got the Premier League table up above me. This is really in honour of my co-author, since this talk is based on a whole bunch of research with my co-author from the Learning School, that's Tara Guerin, and he's a fervent Chelsea supporter, so he's feeling very pleased about Chelsea winning the league this year and being a member of a winning team, whereas my hometown is Stoke, and you can see that Stoke are languishing at position 9 in the Premier League, so I'm not quite so happy. But one of the things that we were interested in our research is what determines really winning teams, and we were very taken by looking at this Premier League and noticing that really there's that threshold. If I think of that threshold at 4 or 5, are you going to get the Champions League place? Are you over the threshold to be a winning rather than a losing team? That was a lot of the motivation for our research. So let me just tell you what's coming up. These are a bunch of themes that's coming up in my talk today, where I'm going to be talking through a sequence of research papers that we've conducted. Because they're all technical and mathematical, I'm actually not going to give you much of the research itself, but rather the motivation that lies behind them. And the beginning of that motivation is thinking about what determines the success and longevity of organizations. So if I can kick off with that question, I'd like to know what determines the success of organizations. And you might think, well, what kind of organizations do I have in mind? Well, it could be a business organization. So I might think of Apple as a prototypical example of a really leading and successful business organization. But even stepping outside the business world, I might think of my own area, really, of politics, thinking about what determines the success of a political party. We've got Hillary Clinton there representing the Democrats. Other organizations outside business and politics may also lie within academia. So if I think about here, an organization such as the University of Warwick, I might think about what determines the success of that organization, or I might think more widely about sports. So if I go back to Chelsea, what determines the success of a team in a sports environment? So that's really kind of the sort of motivation for all of our research. Now, since I am, by profession, a political scientist, at least half of the time, a lot of the work that Tara and Dewey and I have done has been motivated by political settings. And in political settings, we went back and looked at, really, an old quote from a guy called Vernon Key, who's quoted here by Tim Besley back in the 1950s, using slightly sexist language, actually, so I'll correct his language as we go through. He was talking through what determines the success of governments. And he said, well, look, the nature of the workings of government depend on the men who run it, or I prefer to say the people who run it. The people we elect to office and the circumstances that we create that affect their work determine the nature and success and performance of popular government. So if you think about what's going on in this particular quote, it's about the nature of the people in an organization and the incentives that we give them. So the way in which I could kind of map that out is to think about organization's success as being the ultimate aim, and some of the ingredients that go into that might be, for instance, the talent of the people we put into those organizations and the incentives that we give them. So what really Vernon Key was saying is, look, if you've got talent, talent helps you get success, good people, success, and if we give them the right incentives so that they're going to put the effort in, then that's also going to give success. That's very sort of basic and kind of obvious. So what kind of motivated us is to think a little bit more carefully about how these different elements may intertwine. In particular, we were concerned that in fact incentives and talent may affect each other. In particular, as you provide harsh incentives in an organization, perhaps by throwing out those people who fail, perhaps firing those people who screw up, then effectively you may run down the amount of talent that you have in the organization. Moreover, thinking about retaining talent in the organization may affect the incentives that you give to people. If I'm sitting here knowing that Adam A is a key member of my organization, maybe I don't want to give him harsh incentives by firing him because I really need him around. And so a desire to retain talent may affect incentives. So there's a two-way street. Going a little bit further, what we did is realize that there was also a two-way street in the relationship between talent and success and incentives and success. So certainly, if I give you strong incentives to perform well, your organisation may do well. But it's also true that the success of your organisation itself may help to provide incentives for you. So you'll find that most people really want to work for and be members of a successful organisation. Right? So you'll work hard and do well when you think you're going to enable that success of that real winning team. And if it's a losing team, then maybe you won't. That's also going to apply to the talent that we recruit into organisations. In particular, one motivation for many people is they themselves, when they choose where to be, want to be part of that successful organisation. And so the success itself is something that can attract the talent. So what we've been trying to do in our research is trying to exploit the interdependencies between success, incentives, and talent recruitment in organisations by looking at how the arrows go in both directions rather than just one direction. Okay, so that's the kind of background and motivation of what we're interested in. So the next thing I need to worry about is really what the motivations are for really talent recruitment and player performance in organisations such as businesses, sports teams, governments, universities, and indeed elsewhere. Now, if I think about these organisations, if I think about a sports team, if I think about here, academia, at Warwick University, if I think about politics, or if I think something slightly more abstract, if I think about playing for an orchestra as a leading musician, what strikes me about all of these organisations is it's not just about money. Yeah? So in particular, in these organisations, there's a lot of constraints for incentive provision in those organisations. In particular, you can't always use money to motivate people to do what you want. In sports teams, there are salary caps. Here in academia, there are budget constraints, which I think we face on a day-to-day basis. If I think about musicians, it's not entirely clear to me that most musicians are motivated by money. I often think that junior musicians are more motivated by perhaps, you know, meeting people, sex basically, if you like. So there are incentives out there that are not just based on money. Moreover, if I think about organisations such as sport and politics, the kind of things that I can do are very coarse. I can't offer fancy financial contracts. In fact, I'm often restricted as a leader to either firing somebody or keeping them, to either promoting them or leaving them in place. So it's kind of an up or out system. If I think about sports, I can either leave them on the bench or I can actually play them in the field. So it's a very coarse set of instruments. Turn to the participants themselves. Of course, they like money, but they also tend to care about the status and indeed the longevity. How long is their job going to last within a particular team? And is that team going to actually succeed? Now, if I think about people looking at a team and how successful it is, they're also kind of sophisticated. So when people think about an organization that they're going to work for or be part of, they tend to be sophisticated and predict the evolution of that team status, asking not just is the team successful today, but is the team going to win that league, or is it going to achieve power as a government, or be top of the charts in the future? When they do that, they're going to predict that evolution and also compare it to different competing teams. So when you're thinking, am I going to work for organisation A or organisation B, you're going to be asking what's going to be the relative status of those organisations as I evaluate what's going to happen in the future. Finally, and here's where the circle comes all the way around, the evolution of a team depends on the actions of multiple players. So when I think about a team and whether it's going to succeed in the future, I have to ask myself, are other good people going to join that team? Are other good people, when they join that team, going to perform well? So I'm going to anticipate the actions of other people to decide what I'm going to do, which leaves these ideas in the realm of the subject area called game theory, where I think about the actions of others when I decide on my own action. So that's really the background for the constraints and opportunities, really, for incentive provision of organisations. So let's go into this a little bit further and think about what incentivises players to participate and perform. I'm going to kick off now by thinking about actual sports teams, footy, right? So the first thing you might think about, well, motivation has to be, actually money's got to be there, money to burn effectively. So some people, especially football players, like to go out and buy sort of expensive sports cars. I talked to Elizabeth earlier on, who was telling me that she's a sports car enthusiast, apparently. you know, you're telling me. So she's a bit like this. So she dreams of driving a car like this. Okay? So this is actually Stephen Gerrard's car, and this is kind of the obnoxious thing that many leading Premier League football players like to go and spend their money on. So certainly there is money to burn. But that's not the only thing. So if I think about sports teams and footy teams in particular, one of the things that they're interested in is really trophies to lift. So if I go back and think of Ashley Cole, and we can see Ashley Cole here lifting the cup playing for Chelsea, an opportunity that he had playing for Chelsea that he did not have while playing for Arsenal, one of his motivations might have been, right? One of his motivations might have been to actually lift that trophy. There are also slightly more nuanced things. People care about issues such as really time and play. So another player, very interesting, Andre Kramaric, given his opportunity in the Premier League, one of the things he did is he chose to join Leicester rather than Chelsea. And he was concerned that by joining a big team, he wouldn't have enough time on the pitch to showcase his talents. So rather than being motivated by the big money offer, he was motivated by the opportunities he got to perform more on the pitch for a lower ranked team. Also, it's not just time in play. It's also really when to play, right? So if I think about this chap, Emmanuel Abadiol, he is notable in the past, certainly when he was playing for Man City, and only really playing properly when it was a big game. If it was a low game, he didn't really care. But the big game, he really cared about turning up for the big game. So he wanted to play in the big game, which gave real opportunities, actually. Because knowing that he wants to play for the big games gives an extra opportunity for a leader of the organization to decide whether to play in or bench in. So the picture here with these football teams, and it's shared with musicians and academics, and government executives and business people, is it's not just money, but it's lifting trophies, being in a long-lived successful organization, having time in play in the big games. Right. So there's the motivation that we have for recruiting and motivating talented organizations. And now, I guess it's kind of the science bit, because I get to tell you a little bit about some of the papers, or academic papers, that Tara and I have written on the subject. And again, because it's all math, I can't really tell you about that, so I'm actually just going to tell you the motivation and make fun of some contemporary politicians. So the first academic paper we had in this little sequence was one where we were really concerned by this linkage, the linkage between talent and incentives. And we particularly noted that whenever you try to give harsh incentives to people in a political setting, it sometimes involved forcing them to resign. Right? Sometimes over very minor things. You may have seen there's been a political resignation today. I don't know if anybody's seen the newspapers. Have you seen the newspapers today? A resignation from the House of Lords, very minor matter. Apparently, coke and things apparently is not compatible with politics. But notice in that environment, somebody screwed up, and then that meant that the Labour Party, in this case, actually lost a talent member from its organisation. So sacking somebody for poor performance, in this case, taking drugs and various things, actually depleted the talent available. So there's going to be an interrelationship between talent and incentives in political organisations. Now this comes back to this particular chap, the Manuel here. I noted earlier that he's somebody who doesn't really like to play unless it's an important game. So we might like to think, how can a manager of a footy team incentivize a player such as this? Well, one thing that they could always do is just drop him from the starting lineup. Say, look, if you're not going to play in all the good games, if you're going to screw around in all these minor games, whenever it's a big game, I'm just going to bench you and not actually play you. Okay? Now, by doing that, that's great. But the bench may have a scarcity of talent. And in particular, if the bench has a scarcity of talent, a low-quality substitute for him might result in the team's inevitable defeat. And so I've got a difficult trade-off there between providing the right incentives for him to do the right thing and making sure I've got enough talent in the talent pool on the bench of an organisation for that organisation to succeed in the future. Now, that obviously is a kind of setting from within footy, but it's also a setting that's within politics as well. So I realise that a lot of people in the room here are somewhat slightly younger than me, yeah? A lot younger than Adam, eh? For sure, yeah? We can tell a lot of our hair has gone away, this is terrible. But you may not necessarily recognise this politician. This politician is called Margaret Beckett. Margaret Beckett was a leading politician in the previous Labour administration here in the United Kingdom. And I think of her as one of the most outstanding domestic politicians of our time, in the sense that she really had an amazing handle on domestic political issues. But she was a bit rubbish when it came to thinking about international issues, so it was entirely a kind of domestic focus. In order to kind of make fun of her a little bit, I can tell you that Margaret Beckett used to like to take her holidays each year, not going abroad to some nice sunny location, but hanging out in a caravan. So this is the way in which she liked to spend time, cruising around the British Isles in her caravan, not really going outside the country. So that's the kind of person that she was. But despite the fact that she had no international experience, under Tony Blair, she subsequently achieved the position of Foreign Secretary of the United Kingdom. Quite incredible. Now, many people were surprised about Margaret Beckett's appointment as Foreign Secretary. In fact, the most surprised person was Margaret Beckett herself. And when Tony Blair, then the UK Prime Minister, phoned her up and said, "Margaret, I'd like you to be Foreign Secretary," her response was, "That I'm starting to speak my language." Right? So she was surprised. So we might think about, well, what the hell is going on here? Well, what the hell is going on here is the fact that Tony Blair, UK Prime Minister at the time, was kind of running out of talent to put into the leading positions of government. And as he moved through that talent pool of government, that meant he had to bring in people who were less and less and less experienced. So this comes out not just under the government of Tony Blair, the Labour, but the previous government, and you're now all so young that you won't know anything about this government. But if I go back to the earlier Conservative government that operated from 1997 here in the United Kingdom, the Prime Minister was John Major. And John Major had this problem of recruiting talented people to his government. And one of his confidants was a guy called Tristan Garrell Jones. And he described tackling the problem of appointing ministers to governments. And in one of his biography of him, he recalls talking to the Prime Minister when they were trying to fill a junior ministerial position. And his response was, really, with these politicians, I wouldn't employ a single one of them. So the problem that he really faced was that if you include all of the different ranks of government ministers, you have to find a lot of people, maybe 90 people to form a government in the UK. But those people have to be drawn from the members of the UK Parliament, okay? And there are not so many of those guys available. In fact, right, you've only got about 350. So you've got 90 spots to fill and a pool of only 350 people. Garrell Jones went on to say, once you've eliminated the bad, the mad, the drunk, and the over the hill, you've already got rid of 100 of these guys. So you're down to 250, and he says, well, you've got to pick 90 people out of 250. Is it any wonder that the caliber of people in that government is so low, right? So the restriction here is an availability of talent, which limits what you can actually do with that talent in those governments. So this is an academic paper by Torren and by me, where we investigated the interplay between the talent pool serving government and the incentives that we could give to people who operate in those governments. So the kind of ingredients that we had, and I'm not going to give you the math because that would make you very unhappy, is we write down a kind of mathematical model of talent scarcity. You don't have so many good people, and incentive provision. And the way we should think about this in terms of government is a minister's effort is something that benefits the government and kind of slows down the arrival of scandals, such as the one that we've seen in the newspaper this week, with the guy getting caught with drug taking in newspapers, and also policy failures, which we really care about as a government. Now, the problem that you face is you've got this finite talent pool of possible replacements. So you've got to be mindful of the fact that every time you get rid of somebody, you don't have very many replacements that you can actually pick from. And the only tool that you can really use in order to deal with ministers in government is all you can do is either keep them or fire them. It's the only thing a prime minister is actually able to do. Whenever you screw up, you have to resign and you're fired, right? If you do really well, then maybe you can be promoted, but that's about it. So that's the issue that we've got. We've got a government that's going to decide, or a prime minister, which is going to decide when to fire people who are hit by scandal, but at the same time is going to be conscious of the fact that there's a limited pool of talent out there. We've got ministers who don't mind working hard, they'd rather slack off, but they want to keep their jobs, they like being on the pitch. The leader wants better performance, fewer scandals, but also wants the government to last a long time, and a government can only last so long as that government has got a talent pool of available people to serve in that government. So there's the key trade-off. The key trade-off that we investigate in our research is this trade-off between incentives. The harsher the incentives, the more I'm willing to sack those people who screw up, that's great for current performance, but the quicker I burn through all the pool of talent that I've got in an organization. So I've got to exploit that trade-off. So what we actually do in our research is we're able to characterize the optimal way in which you manage a talent pool using this ability to fire people who screw up and say what happens to those incentives in the pool of talent over time. What do we find? Well, we find, from an optimality point of view, that the firing probability, that's the harshness of the scheme, the performance of the government, and in fact the arrival rate of resignations, the arrival rate at which I throw people out of government, are all higher the deeper the talent pool of people available. So firstly, if you've got loads of talent, then you fire people more often, you get high performance, but also you run through that talent pool very, very quickly, because you're throwing people out very, very rapidly. And that basically means that you only get effective performance in the organization when the talent pool is sufficiently deep, and as soon as the talent pool becomes eroded, then suddenly the organization screws up. It turns out that there's nothing that you can do about this. This is an optimal thing to do. You've got that talent there, you've got to threaten them in order to get them to work hard, and that means you're eventually going to run out of good people, and eventually governments and organizations are going to come to an end, and they are going to fail. So when we characterize this, I tried to pick one picture from the paper that you can kind of understand without understanding the math. It kind of looks a bit like this. We can imagine tracking the duration of the government from old to new along the x-axis here. And we can think about the government's performance over time. And each of these lines, these stages, represent what happens when you've got three talented people, two talented people, one talented people, and nobody left. And what happens over time is as the talent pool goes down, the value of the government's fortune is that its performance falls. And what also happens is the periods by which these guys last gets longer. So at the beginning of government, people don't last for very long, even though their performance is high. Towards the end of the government, people are performing really badly, and yet they stay in their jobs for a long period of time, which seems kind of back to front. However, it turns out that's an inevitable and optimal response to managing the talent pool of government. And so all governments are going to have this feature that as we get to the end of their period in office, they're going to be rubbish, and rubbish people are going to stay in office for a long period of time, and it turns out that is actually the optimal way to manage talent within an organization. I can bring that back to another story by going back to John Major, former British Prime Minister in the Tory years before 1997. And he had a bunch of politicians who some of us may recognize, Avenue will recognize them, in his cabinet. These guys, I've got Peter Lilly here, Michael Howard, and Michael Portillo. And these were described by John Major, the Prime Minister, as the bastards in his cabinet. That's actually how he described them. When he was on a mic being interviewed and he thought the mic was off, and he said exactly what he thought about them. So these three people were all people who were challenging his authority. They were campaigning really for European Union exit, where he was pro-European Union, and yet he didn't fire them. One of the reasons he didn't fire them is he didn't have anybody left, and he'd worked his way through all of the good people. So here, things for the government in this era got really bad, right? Loads of people had fallen, and the number of incompetents and has-beens had grown. And there were this group of people outside who'd already served in government and been worn out, so you couldn't kind of bring them back in. It was commented that small wonder that it was hard for John Major to give his government an aura of competence. This is really kind of inevitable of what's going to happen in any of these scenarios. So that's the first thing, the first dimension, if you like, of managing the relationship between incentives and talent in organizations. But I want to look at another dimension now. But I want to think about how governments and other organizations sometimes have honeymoons and sometimes have crises of confidence. And what I want to look at now is the linkage between an organization's success and the incentives that people have to pull well. So the idea now is that if an organization is successful, then people want to work hard for that organization. And if people work hard for that organisation, that indeed that organisation may be successful. This, from the way I tell the story, may lead you correctly to think that there could be self-fulfilling prophecies here. If I believe in the success of an organisation, I will work hard for it, and so it will be successful. But if we have pessimistic expectations, they could be self-reinforcing and an organisation can collapse because everybody thinks it's going to fail, and therefore everybody slacks off. So going into this, what's this motivated by? Well, it's motivated by another political example. Here we've got the immediate former Prime Minister, or no, not the immediate, two back, sorry, Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Tony Blair. I should own up and say that I'm a Blairite, so I'll probably make me unpopular amongst many people. But Tony Blair enjoyed really a honeymoon in his government, when his government kind of performed well and people had confidence in that government. But eventually, he passed on the baton of government in 2007 to his successor, Prime Minister Gordon Brown. Prime Minister Gordon Brown also enjoyed a bit of a honeymoon in government. He was feeling very confident. And as you can see behind me, Gordon Brown is looking very cocky. He's got his hand in the air like this, giving the universal, I think he's talking to Tony Blair, because he's giving the universal saying, Tony Blair, I've been videoed, so I can't say, so you know what he's saying, right? A little bit later, actually, of course, Gordon Brown realised that, in fact, it was he who was the wanker, but never mind. So what actually happened with these politicians? Well, what happened with these politicians is Gordon Brown experienced two different zones of success in his team, an early zone where there was a honeymoon, where there was confidence in their success, and a later period where expectations were very pessimistic in his government. So I think about this, and I know that politics, football, and other areas, academia, business, they're all really team sports. And in these team sports, you know, the success of the team depends on everybody contributing their effort to that team. Okay? Now, if I think about team members, then they're going to foresee the efforts of others and how that's going to evolve into the team's particular fortunes. So bearing that in mind, a crucial worry for them is that others foresee the evolution of the team in the same way. So if I'm going to work hard for a team, I want to think it's successful, but I really need to know that other things, other people, also think that team is going to be successful. And this brings us back to this idea that there can be either pessimistic or optimistic self-fulfilling prophecies. Whenever we believe in an organization, we believe it succeeds, we work hard, and it does succeed. So to illustrate how that might work in reality, I've got some data here on measuring the confidence of the success for a particular team. And the team in question here is the previous Labour government here in the United Kingdom. So the United Kingdom, I've started this graph in May 2007, and I'm going to run it up over just over a year towards the end of 2008. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and measure confidence in the government about how likely we are to think it succeeds. One way to measure the success or confidence in the government is to say, how confident are we that that government is going to be re-elected at the next election? And one way in which we can do that is we can look to trading data. So you can go and bet on outcomes from future election outcomes, and you can trade those bets between different people on betting markets. So there's one betting market here on this 500 days of the Blair Brown era called Intrade. And Intrade has a closing price for a Labour victory in the next election. That, in effect, is a measure of the confidence. You can view it as a percentage confidence that Labour are going to succeed, and we can track that price over time. So what we actually see at the beginning of this era, Blair is in charge, and confidence is actually increasing. And confidence starts increasing even more when Blair steps down in favour of Gordon Brown, and then we have 100 days of government where confidence increases. Everybody believes in Brown as a winning team. Confidence increases. Everybody is willing to join in with his particular group or his particular team over that era. However, at the end of that 100 days, there's a 100-day gap between those two periods, there was an event where Brown got cold feet. He was going to call the general election at that particular point. And he kind of cancelled that general election, which indicated that he himself had a lack of confidence in the organization's success. So the fact that he didn't call the election meant that he didn't have the confidence, which meant that people in his team no longer had the confidence, which meant that they had less incentives to work for an organization that they thought wasn't going to succeed in the future. So at that point, after the honeymoon, we actually saw a collapse or a crisis of confidence. And we can see that in the data. After Brown's 100 days in office, it drops off. So if I track the in-trade data, I see the crisis of confidence actually happen. Now in this period of time, Brown started to have more and more and more problems disciplining the people within his team. The reason is, they've got less to fight for because they don't think their team is going to be around for a long time. In fact, that really manifested itself to the next period where Labour had some really poor performance in local elections, and at that period, people started leaving the Labour government and going to outside jobs because they thought they were going to be out of a job at the next election, and confidence fell even further. So what we had in these periods is a crisis of confidence where people thought it was turning from a winning team into a losing team. And in that first era, people started slacking off by not performing in government the way in which they should. And in that second half of that era, people started leaving the government, and Brown couldn't actually bring in the talent who would work for that government because they no longer had confidence in it. So what we actually do here in our research, in the second of the three academic papers I'm talking about today, is we mathematically modeled, really, the evolving confidence and performance of governments and other teams. So it's a mathematical model again. We model the individual effort and the performance of teams. And the key math of it is we model the evolving quality of a team or the performance of a government as evolving via a noisy process. Mathematically, it's ground in motion, but it can be modeled and influenced by the actions of those within it. The key element for a government and a sports team is if your popularity hits zero, you die. You get thrown out of offices of government, you get relegated if you're in the Premier League, yes? Okay. Now, where you move in that league, whether you drift up or drift down, depends on people putting in high or low effort, which of course depends on their expectations for the future of the team. Okay? So, what do people worry about? Well, if I'm in a government, then I'm willing to put high effort in because I might get sacked. But I only care about getting sacked if I value my career. So what's really important is for team members to value their positions. Now, as soon as I think I'm in a crisis of confidence towards the end of a government or the end of a team, I think I'm going to lose my job anyway, so I don't really care if I get fired. Therefore, the threat to force me to resign or throw me out of the team no longer carries any weight if my career value is sufficiently low. So what we do is we mathematically, jointly model and calculate the values of careers within teams, such as governments, and the evolution of the popularity and the confidence of those teams to see what happens, to see whether in the long term the government succeeds or whether it actually fails. And one of our first findings is, in a world where there's no noise or no random events in the system, then we can get multiple self-fulfilling prophecies. That is, if we're all optimistic, we all work hard, the team succeeds, it lasts forever. But if we're all pessimistic, the opposite happens. However, a property of our research is that as soon as there are random events, there are little butterflies' wings and other things that can disturb the evolution of the government, there are those bad outcomes that can tip things one way or the other, we're able to pin down uniquely what happens to an organization in the future. So we find that with positive noise, we can find a unique profile for what happens to a government and their team. And the critical element of that profile is there's a unique popularity threshold for a team or for a government. In other words, there's a unique state in the opinion polls. Above that, people are confident, and it goes well and goes up. Below that, confidence collapses and you go down. So there's a key line in the sand. It's a bit like a line in the sand in the Premier League. If you go below 6 or 7 in the Premier League, game over, you ain't going to be winning the league this year. We're able to tell you exactly where that line is and how that line responds to different features of the kind of government. So to go back, I'm just going to tell you how this kind of works. Well, the rough thing, and this is the only technical bit of this whole talk, I guess. One way you can think about this is you can think about a team's popularity or quality or government's performance going from left to right. So over here on the left, you can think about zero popularity, over on the right, 100% popularity. And I can think about what would be true of the value of my career in a team which is a winning team. A winning team is one where people are working hard. Well, a winning team gives you a high career value, and that career value is higher the current quality and performance of the team. Moreover, if people are working hard, you tend to move to the right. That's the evolution of the team going up. And if you get to the winning line right at the end, the team's got kind of 100% success. The flip side is when you're in a losing team. So a losing team is when everybody's slacking off, or I can't get any good people to work for my team. And the trajectory is downwards, you're moving to the left. And because you're moving to the left and the team's going down, the value of the career in it is not worth very much, because eventually, when the team's popularity hits zero, you die and you're out of a job. So the key problem that we've got here is people need enough value in their careers in order to deliver effort. Right? So I need to care enough in order to work hard. So where I've drawn this line, if you're above that line, I care enough and I work hard and we're in the winning team. But if you think we're in the losing team regime, we're below that line and so I slack off. What we're able to do in our research, however, is tell you which of those trajectories we're actually on. So although I can't tell you the details, all I can tell you is that we can find a critical point of popularity, I've labeled it with a star here, and we can identify by tracking the mathematics that if you're to the right of that line, then people's expectations are optimistic and you go up, and see if you're to the left of that star line, your expectations are optimistic and you go down. So we can kind of like, if you like, solid those lines and tell you that it's critically important to have an organization which has popularity or confidence or quality to the right of that threshold, because only then do people's optimistic expectations become embedded. And if you go below, then you're kind of screwed. Yeah? Okay, good. So let's see what actually happens when we roll forward with a team in this kind of environment. Well, I can think about a team's time and play. I can think about the team's kind of current quality, and I can think about what actually happens to that team over time. What really happens to that team over time, I can think about its max quality. That's like being at the top of the Premier League, whereas being down to zero is where you completely fail. And there's going to be a critical threshold, so I'm now going to put this threshold quality level, and if you go below that, expectations become pessimistic. But when we track the team's qualities over time, they kind of look something like this. So a team over time has good days and bad days and gets hit by noise. So if you see the jags in the line here, this is like random events. You lose again. You have a policy failure. You have a resignation. But you recover from that and keep going back to a maximum team quality and performance. But if ever you get hit by a sufficiently large number of negative shocks, like you do here in the middle, as soon as you get pushed below, expectations flip, and then you get pushed into this downward trajectory. So by modeling the patterns of the organizations over time, we can draw pictures like this, and we can see how critically important it is to watch out for those events that push a team's current quality below a critical threshold, right, below which it will all fail. Here at Warwick, I was telling Abinay earlier on, that's why we need to keep Abinay here at Warwick. As soon as we lose Abinay, we go below the threshold. Okay, finally, I want to talk about a third academic paper about playing for really winning teams. And this is really about this dimension. So this is not about effort, but by the willingness to get good people to join an organization. So all of you, when you go out there, go out into the world and you graduate, you could be like me and go off to grad school because you can't afford to get a job. Or I think I'm still in that state, actually. Or you might evaluate jobs with different organizations. And when you do that, you'll want to play for a winning team or a successful team. But of course, you'll recognize that that team is successful simply because it can retain and recruit the most talented people to join that team. So there's an interplay between talent and success. Going back to the evolution of confidence in the UK government, at least under Tony Blair and then Gordon Brown, this really happened around this point here, at point three. So if I think about May 2008, this is a point at which people started deciding that they thought the team wasn't a winning team anymore, and they started leaving it. And I think this is captured in a really lovely way by this cartoon. So if I look at this cartoon, you'll see here that this is a ship. And it's a ship that's sinking. And on it, it says, Her Majesty's Ship, New Labour. That's the previous Labour government in the United Kingdom. And you can see the captain of the ship. The captain of the ship, the leader. That was the Prime Minister, Gordon Brown. And you see who's jumping off the ship? The rats. The rats were leaving the sinking ship. And what you'll notice for the rats leaving the sinking ship is they're all clutching these red briefcases. So in UK government, government ministers carry these things called ministerial boxes, which are red briefcases which contain all their ministerial papers. So what this cartoon is telling you is the Labour ship is going down, and the rats, they're the ministers, are leaving the sinking ship. And that's what happened in May 2008, when we had a sequence of resignations and moves out of the Labour government, as people thought that the writing was on the wall, and so they kind of left as we moved into that era, where there was a crisis of confidence, which stopped the recruitment of talent to that organisation. And this is also kind of related to the person at the top right, which is Ashley Cole. So actually, I should ask, any Chelsea fans in here? Any Chelsea fans? Any Arsenal fans in here, by any chance? Arsenal, you can leave. okay, so unfortunately, I can't make as much fun about Arsenal this year, right? Because they did okay, right? They actually got a bit silver, so you feel like a bit happy, but someone's probably going to shout now, Arsenal fans, right? So I'm thinking about football teams. I think about Ashley Cole. So Ashley Cole, back, you know, getting over 10 years ago now, left Arsenal to join Chelsea. And some people said it was all about the money, right? And they started calling him Cashley Cole, because they said he'd just been hired by Chelsea just because he liked boatloads of cash, right? But we might ask whether that was the right moniker, because Ashley Cole then went and tweeted or sent out a graphic which illustrated, up until this year, I should add, it's not valid this year, since Ashley Cole left in Arsenal in 2006, here's what happened to Ashley Cole, and here's what happened to Arsenal. So we saw Chelsea with a whole shelf full of silverware, whereas we saw Arsenal, the team that he left, not winning anything. And one of the things he said he prized is lifting trophies and wanting to be part of a winning team rather than a losing team. So this is a genuine motivation for people. So this is what motivated the last paper I'll talk about, playing for a winning team, where we modeled recruitment and team quality in an organization. And the idea here is the team quality evolves via some Grammy motion again, and the team dies and whose quality dies. I'll go through the details here. The key idea is good people drive the team up, bad people drive the team down. But to get good people, better quality recruits have got better outside options, and so they need to have more confidence in the team before they're willing to join it. Right? You can think about this as a high-low world. You know, you've got good guys and you've got bad guys. I'm going to think of Ashley Cole in this sense as a good guy. Now the key thing is the talent pool for an organization now becomes endogenous. The people you can recruit kind of really depends on whether they're willing to serve you. So they look at the organization and predict its evolution to decide whether they're going to be a member of the talent pool. So what we find in this environment is the research shows that if there's no noise in the system, then again you can have these multiple self-fulfilling prophecies. Chelsea succeeds because people believe it's going to succeed, and so Ashley Cole is willing to join Chelsea. But as soon as we have noise in the system, then again we get the same property. We find that the teams have a critical quality threshold where they can attract good people if and only if there are a critical number of good people in the organization already. In a conversation before we came in here, I talked to Abhinay about recruitment to a winning team here, which is the economics department here at Warwick University. And one of the things that I noted that Abhinay has talked about when he's recruiting talented people, he's been very careful to tell people how many talented people he's already got in his organization and showcase them. And what he's really doing is saying, the current stock of talent is above a threshold. You can have confidence that my team is a winning team that's going to succeed in the future. Please come and join me. So we find again that there's a key critical threshold. You've got to have enough talented people, and then you can draw people in. And we can tell you how that threshold responds to things like your outside option, the career benefits within the organization, and to the flow rates up and down of quality of the team as you get good people and bad people. But the kind of more interesting results show it also depends on the noise in the system. And the key thing that we find is when the system of recruitment is noisy, right, it turns out that increasing the noise in the system when good types are the ones being recruited tends to be bad for the system. And increasing the noise in the system when only bad types are being recruited is good for the system. I'll say that again. Noise in recruitment is good, right, when you're only able to hire bad people. Noise in the system is bad when you're able to hire good people. Why is this? Well, when you've got good people in your team already and you can hire good people, you don't want to be taking any chances. You don't want to run any risks that you hire a bad apple that pushes the quality of the team below a threshold and results in this collapse. But if your team is just below the threshold it needs to be successful, so you can only recruit bad or mediocre people, then it's a good idea to gamble for resurrection. So if you gamble on somebody who might be good and they might be bad, if they turn out to be good, they might be just good enough to push your team above the threshold and move it into an optimistic world. So what we're able to do is we're able to characterize our different recruitment strategies affect the performance of teams. And a final finding that we had in this this environment is we also found that stepping stones were important. So in organizations which start off with low quality people, it's really good idea to have medium quality people around you. Because if you can get the medium quality people in, then the team might move up slightly, which might be enough to attract in the really good people. Yeah? So that's what's happening really here at Warwick. Warwick are very keen, really, to hire Abinay, right, as the mediocre person, in the hope that I think the team is going to succeed enough that the good people, that's me, will eventually come and join. So it's a good idea to have the mediocre as well as the bad around in that system. So intermediate types could be a stepping stone.
You've got two words, sir.
Thank you. As soon as I start talking about you, you throw me off. It's not really terrible. What is he doing like this? Okay, so the final thing we have is we are also doing stuff on competing teams as well. I can't tell you about this back in detail, but we're also dealing with teams where we think about people choosing which team to actually play for, where people have preferences over whether they like to play for their home team or an away team. So if you're a Fotty player, presumably you prefer to play for Arsenal than play for Chelsea, but maybe you'd switch to Chelsea if you thought Arsenal were definitely going to go out of Premier League. No, you're not loyal. That's the loyalty. I like that. That's very good. Okay, so what we have in those environments with competing teams is we're also able to model the evolution of how teams work when people have to choose which team to actually play for and then compare two different teams. I'm not going to tell you the different results in our analysis. They're on the next slide, but I'm going to skip it in a moment. But what we actually find out is the relative importance about how much people care about playing for their home team, the importance of how much it matters to lift a trophy, even if that trophy is your away team, if you like, and how much you feel pain when you lose with a home team versus an away team. We can put all those things together and we can characterize when people will play for one team or the other team. So it's not just winning or losing teams, it's which team is going to be the winner, given there's always going to be one. Okay, so that's the bit that I'm going to skip out here, and I'm also going to skip my stuff on environmental issues. I'm going to conclude with some lessons on organizations. So my lessons are going to come back to this kind of motivating picture that I had, where I put these arrows on. So the starting point for economics and politics has always been this idea that there's a one-way street, where talent and incentives together give you success. But in recent research, through a sequence of academic papers, we're trying to model the interplay, noting that success itself can attract talent, success itself can provide incentives, and therefore we can have different self-fulfilling prophecies in each of those dimensions. And in our earlier work, we're able to say, look, it really matters when you're managing incentives in organizations to know that putting in good incentives can also affect the talent pool of people that you have to actually play with.
Good.
Okay, you're only going to be 1 minute, so I don't
So a big cheers to...